Now to South Africa. There's no shortage of bleak stories coming out of Africa these days, but this one coming up is anything but. There's an election there next week, and David O'Shea went to take the political pulse of the post-apartheid generation, now voting for the first time. What he discovers, despite the nation's problems, is a generation with a very upbeat view of their future.
Meet Mandela's legacy, South Africa's youth. Born young enough to not know the extreme and legalized racism during apartheid, or see hundreds die in the struggle for equality and freedom. So as they head toward a national election, what does it mean to them to be a born free? Today's generation, as filmed here by a local photographer, may be finding answers in pop culture rather than politics.
I am 20 years old this year. I'm turning 20
in April.
The 12th of April, yes.
So you were born just...
Yeah, I was like 14 days before the first democratic elections.
A true born free.
Yeah.
Nutty's mum is taking me to a place which has great meaning to her, to discuss the legacy of apartheid today in their family.
This is where it all happened.
Took place in 1976.
In 1976, around 20,000 students rioted against the introduction of Afrikaans language in schools. No one's sure how many died in the Soweto riots, but some say up to 700 people lost their lives. Nutty's mum was there.
Yes, I was there, physically and everything.
You almost got shot. Weren't you scared?
I was so scared because we don't know where did the policemen come from, because they came from this direction. And then the police started shooting.
Oh. When I get a job one day, I want to drive a Hummer.
For Nutty and her mother, the past is still a big part of their lives today.
It's equally as important to her as it is to me, because she was a part of it. That's why it's so important, because if it wasn't for them, we wouldn't be right where we are.
Do you think the generation appreciates this?
There are 50% who appreciate what we did, 50% who doesn't appreciate, of which the people who don't appreciate is that I take them as the people who don't care.
So the election is coming up soon. Do you both know who you'll be voting for?
I know who I'll be voting for.
The devil we know.
Yeah, the devil we know the better.
The devil you know they're referring to is the ruling African National Congress, the party of Nelson Mandela. They've ruled for 20 years, and despite increasing criticism, no other party has been able to seriously challenge them. And the youth aren't waiting around for the government to deliver.
Who are you guys?
He's Sibu, I'm Letabo.
But if you like, you can call us Smarties.
Can't be seen in the same outfit three times. Twice is fine. Three times, God, it's embarrassing. Spit on the ground and people who do that walk on.
Young designers, the Smarties, say their name is just like the candy. Colourful on the outside and black on the inside.
How do you find anything in here?
Their work has featured in style magazines and blogs around the world. They're not old enough to remember the struggle against apartheid. They say their struggle is against blandness and conformity.
Just Jackson Pollock, quick.
Fashion doesn't always make sense to me. To explain how this creativity is linked to the legacy of apartheid and politics, they're taking me to a rooftop party.
So what does it say about your generation, fashion?
I want to say fashion, but the art in general say about our generation that we don't need anyone to build us, make us money, or give us anything. Do you understand how awesome it is that I'm weird? You are Australian. You are here to talk to me because I look this way.
Are you going to be voting in the election?
If I vote, who am I voting for? Why? They have been doing the same shit. Beep that. I'm gonna say shit. I won't wanna beep myself because they do shit.
I mean, you can't wait for the government to buy you a house. You need to work your ass out. You know, you need to involve yourself. You need to work. You can't just wait. It's like, you know what? I was affected by apartheid. Then now the government has to buy you a house, buy
our
a car.
Our parents were affected by apartheid. Yeah, everything we have, we made ourselves.
Exactly.
So if you're our age and you say apartheid, you're a lazy fuck.
The legacy of apartheid is nothing tangible. It's something inside me, something inside everybody else who lived throughout the era of apartheid.
In Meadowlands, Soweto, Mpo is collecting water from the outside yard. They don't have running water in the house, and he wants to make a cup of tea for his grandmother.
My hopes for Mpo is to get what he wants in life.
Mpo lost both his parents as a child. His father was murdered. He was raised by his grandmother and aunties in a pro-ANC household.
I haven't seen much change, though there is, but for me as an individual, there isn't much. There's so much poverty. They do things that they're not supposed to do, like stealing, getting to drugs. And you see the poor souls, they're not doing this because they love it. It's oppression that goes within them.
But optimism for the future is still alive in this house.
She's not relying on the opportunities of me becoming something, you know. She's relying on my ambition and the passion that I have be a successful person beyond the opportunities of the bone freeze that they say are there.
Mpo's been arrested 4 times for drugs. Now he's trying to follow his passion as a writer. He's been given the chance to be an intern at an initiative called Live Magazine.
So yeah, I'm just going to go through a rundown of how everyone's going through the articles.
Hey, well, the article is based on a genre called kwaito.
Everyone working in this room has the right to vote next week. But it's a right Mpo may not be exercising.
The main reason behind me not wanting to vote is because I've seen my grandmother vote so many times for change and nothing has came. Because majority of the guys in my family are the cliche blacks. In jail, dead, hijackers, other cliche. I'm like the last of the dying breed.
What's the most important thing in your life?
Right now. Success, actually. My family has been hungry for too long.
The Born Frees are also mixing the past with the present in ways that work for them. In the 50s, Pansula was a protest dance that emerged out of Johannesburg's townships, a form of resistance. Today, they can build a career from touring as a Pansula dancer.
And what do you feel when you're dancing this? What's the emotion?
It feels I have courage to do this. Mm. I have lots of courage because I know it. It's in my blood. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Many of the dancers told me they grew up with only one or no parents. Top Pansula groups get paid, and some have gone on to become celebrities.
If there was still apartheid, maybe I would have been working a cleaner or a guardian, you know. But now, as Mandela have fought the struggle, now I can dance, I can travel the world, I can go to France, I can go to Europe.
We have to pull up our socks so that we can live a good life.
Yes. We have to work as a slave and live like a king.
That's how it is. That's how it is.
Some people I've spoken to say that nothing really has changed here. What do you think about that?
That's not true.
That's not true.
Because it's changed a lot.
A lot of things change. We got schools, government schools.
We've grown.
Where, yeah, where we don't pay school fees, you just go to school.
And
yeah.
You're free to go anywhere.
Yeah. If you're between 18 and 25 years old here, there's a 55% unemployment rate. The country's been in recession since 2009. The rand has dropped, but South Africa's stocks in cultural cool have gone up. And for a young generation, this has become a small economic lifeline. Artists like Bubesi sell their music or fashion online to a global market.
Basically, people are making their own opportunities now.
Yeah, because also it has to do with the whole political thing where the landscape of, you know, becoming into a new democracy and finding yourself and actually not waiting for someone to kind of give you handouts and actually just being your own ambassador and just you can actually do it.
This generation is also getting involved in the city's revamp. Change may be too slow for some since the end of apartheid, but pockets of the city are safer and cleaner. Becky is dubbed the tourism minister of Maboneng. At 21, he's already a respected entrepreneur, opening Joburg's first inner city backpackers.
It's based on mixing the old and the new, just creating a new progressive, like, architecture or aesthetic within the entire neighborhood itself.
What can you tell me about this area? Are you noticing a change?
There is a big change, actually, because I'm so used to Joburg being, no, Joburg is dangerous. Mm. You mustn't go to Joburg alone, especially as a girl. Mm. So yeah, it's changing, man. It's nice.
There's Leroy. Leroy!
Leroy is working on a project to improve the building across from Becky's backpackers. The people who live here are without proper access to electricity or water.
I think the strategy also that we've used is very different to how other developers, you know, where they come, eradicate the existing people, and then occupy the space for their own use.
What I was trying to do, ne, is this space is going to be part of the kitchen because we're going to do communal kitchen.
You're the service providers that everybody accuses the government of not being.
We no longer can wait for our country to be developed by them. We have to take our country by our own hands and start developing it ourselves and finding an innovative ways to make sure that it can happen.
Do that shot.
The downtown rebuild is being led by another young South African, Jonathan Liebman. His company, Propetuity, has invested around $100 million into the area and entrepreneurs like Becky.
Born Frees have played a massive role in the development of Maboneng. I've connected and collaborated with lots of really young black South Africans that are, you know, 20, 21, 22, starting up businesses in the neighborhood.
And does that describe Becky, does it?
Yeah, I mean, Becky is like the classic case.
Born Frees are also using their newfound democracy to explore controversial topics, bringing new meaning to the past.
Like, everyone told me to not do it, and that's what motivated me to do it.
Mbongeni is making t-shirts with the white racist slur kafir. Once so offensive, people now call it the K word.
Is the word as bad as it, as people tell me it is?
Yes. It is. It is, but like only to adults and stuff, you know. To the youth, it really doesn't have that much of a significance because, like, we're not affected by that word in any way.
We're not trying to hurt people or make them go back to the past. We're just trying to make peace with the fact that we were called kafirs.
Yeah. We're not raised to like look at color and stuff, you know. That was our parents' struggle.
Well, what is your struggle?
Man, our struggle.
Ooh. Our struggle.
Financial independence.
Yes, financial independence.
What do you think Nelson Mandela would have thought of your t-shirts?
Well, Nelson Mandela is a very open-minded person. I think he would have loved the t-shirts, you know.
He taught us about forgiveness, you know. That's the most important thing he taught us, forgiveness. So if we could forgive like a whole race, like, I don't think he'd have a problem with these t-shirts, you know. Like.
My studio's very simple, eh?
Mongeni tie-dyes his t-shirts from home. He does everything on the balcony of his mum's flat. Although at first, she didn't allow him to wear the t-shirt in the house.
Came out perfect. What does the word mean to you?
At the time, it did belittle me.
it didn't make me feel good about myself as a human being. I'm not very happy about it also, because I'm the child of apartheid. I don't think they know much what happened in the past.
Did you try and convince him not to go down this path?
I did.
He failed?
Well, he agreed that he will make a change. He said he will turn the eye down. I don't know, but it will still be there. That doesn't make a difference. Who's
a summer? Now the only thing I need on this track is some. These photographs belong to a young white South African who focuses on youth subculture. His images have sold around the world and made the cover of South African Rolling Stone magazine.
Why are your subjects interesting? It's obviously not only because of the fashion they're wearing or the music they're making. It's more than that, isn't it?
When people see the images that I shoot of South Africa and see how colorful and vibrant and positive South African culture is, it's the exact opposite of the idea that they have of Africa. First it was like we got peace and everything was great and fantastic, but there was nothing about who we were. And I think that was an important thing for me.
Next week, South Africa will go to the polls, and it's predicted the ANC will remain in power. President Jacob Zuma has promised 6 million jobs. Opposition parties have expressed their doubts. For Mpo, the election results will be of little consequence. He's just focused on staying on the straight and narrow.
I don't understand the term free for me now as someone born in the 90s, you know.
I'm not free, got my own struggles, but it's one of those battles that I believe I'll stay winning. I'll stay winning.
Mpo has a chance in life that wasn't available to his parents. They fought for freedom, and now their children are determined to forge their own future.
Nice to see something a bit upbeat out of Africa. That story produced by Bernardine Lim. You can go to our website to find out more about the Born Frees in David's story. And there's a gallery from another young Joburg photographer telling his story of success. That's at sbs.com.au/dateline.